So we certainly want to honor those who have served before us, and I know that at the previous service we asked people who had served our country, or those who have children or fathers or aunts, uncles who have served our country, would you please stand for us? If you have been a veteran or if you have someone standing, just give them a big hand. My father was a pilot in the Air Force, and he was the first, last wave to be a pilot for B-52, so he was young enough that he didn't go across the ocean. But my father-in-law served 2 terms in Vietnam and 1 Korea, and he never spoke about it. Very powerful experience for him, but it helps us understand that freedom is not free. It costs. And it helps us understand to look a bigger picture of what Memorial Day means to you. I just read a really interesting book by Madeleine Albright, who at 8 years old is still a wonderfully sharp mind. She had to flee Czechoslovakia, her own country, twice in her life. And she became an American citizen. And it impressed me how much they celebrated Memorial Day, as opposed to my usual custom. And it made me think bigger about Memorial Day. And so I hope you have a wonderful experience, and certainly has been so far today. But also, we know that, as Josh said, it's Trinity Sunday, and it's a challenge for us to think bigger about who God is to you. How big is your God? How would you answer the question if your 10-year-old or 10-year-old child or 10-year-old grandchild comes up to you and asks you to describe God? How are you going to do that? What words are you going to say? How big is God to you? And it reminds me of expanding from memorial, our understanding to give thanks for freedom, but expanding our understanding of God more than our normal scriptures or our rote memory of what we've memorized. It was 9 years ago this month, May 24th, that I gave my first sermon at Highland. And I gave it on a theme, to boldly go. Anybody remember what theme that was? What sci-fi movie? Star Trek, right? If you know me, I'm a sci-fi, that was Star Wars, it didn't count. Star Trek is the one that really counts, right? Well, there's a new one that came out, and you probably want to see it, and it's called Guardians of the Galaxy. Anybody seen that one? 2014, it grossed $770 million. They said, that's pretty good, we'll do it again. So it's last year they did it again, Volume 2, and they grossed another $90 million. It was the 6th highest grossing movie of 2017, and it really is a funny plot. A lot of one-liners, superpower, not really superpowers, but just kind of these people get together and become the guardians of the galaxy. And, stay on the edge of your seat, because Volume 3 is coming out in 2020. All right, they got a good thing going, and they're flowing with it. But it made me think, this title, Guardians of the Galaxy, and it made me think bigger in terms of my understanding of who is my guardian. The one not only of the galaxy and the universe, but of my life, the guardian of my life. And so I wanted to try to expand our thoughts and just walk through this together with you, and to look at a particular text from Isaiah. And so if you want to, first of all, you've got it in the bulletin, right? You got your bulletin, and the text is right there in your bulletin from Isaiah 6. And you should have sermon notes, so you could fall asleep in this sermon and still know what I'm talking about. Get full credit when I ask you to sign in pages. So some sermons are more conducive to sharing some notes. And what I wanted to share with you, it's just a lot of cut and pasting because there's so many scripture passages that I know some of you will want to reread. And what was he talking about this? And that's what the sermon notes are. They're mostly passages, okay? because they are supporting some of the statements, but you can't get better than the scripture passage itself. So if you look at scripture and you talk about the guardian of the galaxy and you're thinking, who is this ruler of everything, this omnipotentate of innumerable universes throughout the galaxies, and is more powerful and fearful and wise than ever you could imagine, and in this text, more holy. So listen to God's word to you as we find it in Isaiah 6. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord, high and exalted, seated on a throne, and the train of his robe, it filled the temple. Above him were seraphim, each with six wings. With two wings they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, and with two they were flying. And they were calling to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory." At the sound of their voices, the doorposts and thresholds shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. "Woe to me," I cried, "I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. And my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty." Then one of the seraphim flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. With it he touched my mouth and said, "See, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away, and your sin is atoned for." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send? And who will go for us?" And I said, "Here am I. Send me." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Would you pray with me? Almighty God, we open this text and we read Isaiah's vision, this epiphany of your appearance, and his attempt to describe the indescribable. Lord, we pray that you would open our minds, our hearts, our understanding to see more clearly how big you are, how awesome you are, how amazing you are. The guardian of the galaxy. In your name we pray. Amen. So some of you know I sometimes use art, and I was looking through a bunch of art because there's all kinds of artists, classical and different types of depiction of the artist's understanding of God. And you know, the more I look through them, the more they look like Charlton Heston with a big beard. And I thought, yeah, that's not going to cut it, all right? So what are we going to do with trying to understand who God is when we're trying to describe the indescribable? And so here, I'd love to see this depiction that we just read. Wouldn't you love to see some producer put that on a modern movie? Maybe hire Steven Spielberg for some special effects? I mean, think about it. Someone is going to do this someday. Look, all the elements. A powerful being whose glory covers the whole earth. Cool clothes. Celestial beings are flying with six wings. A kind of a lofty throne somewhere way up there. Earthquakes, smoke, pyrotechnics are great. And a really neat name, this all-powerful being, the King, the Lord of Hosts. I mean, this description of all of this is more than you can imagine. And so what would someone do to put it before us in vision? See, Isaiah is a great place to start. The whole book of Isaiah, if you're trying to understand a little bit better of the providence of God, the nature of God, what theologians call the attributes of God, that we can understand who God is as a guardian. In Isaiah 40, Isaiah, and these are marked down here for later, but Isaiah 40 says, who has measured the waters in the hollow of his hand and marked off the heavens with a span, enclosed the dust of the earth in a measure, and weighed the mountains in scales and the hills in balance? Who's so big that they could do this? Isaiah is saying. Not only is God the guardian in this passage, but God is the creator of everything that is now being guarded. And stated in that same chapter a few verses later, all the nations are as nothing before him. They are accounted by him as less than nothing and emptiness. To whom then will you liken God? Or what likeness compares with him? How do you describe the indescribable? Isaiah keeps digging deeper and he goes further into chapter 40. He says, have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the very beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circles of the earth, and its inhabitants are like little grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to live in, who brings princes to naught, and makes the rulers of the earth as nothing. If you really want to think big about God, Isaiah is a great place to start. Actually, you can find different attributes of God all through the scriptures. You can find all kinds of words that are trying to describe this indescribable, the eternalness of God, the goodness, the grace, the holiness, the immanence, the immutability, the justice, the love, the mercy, the omnipotence, the omnipresence, the omniscience, righteousness, self-existence, sovereignty, transcendence. You could go through the scriptures and come up with all these words, nouns, adjectives that are trying to describe God. So how big is your God? Well, let me try to answer that question to you briefly. Let me try to tell you what I would do if I had someone say, would you please describe God to me? Because in those terms, I would probably start, if I were trying to say the guardian of the galaxy and the guardian of my soul is one who is omni, whatever, the omnipresence, omniscience. You see, when you think about God being everywhere at the same time, you probably are going back to Genesis 1, in the beginning. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. He's back there in the beginning, always was. Or you might jump up to the Gospel of John, who also picked up the same words from the Genesis in order to let people know that this was the new Gospel here. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. These are those verses that you go to when you start thinking about who could possibly be everywhere at one time or know everything about everything. Anselm. Some of you know Anselm of Canterbury in the 11th century or so. He came out with a really interesting statement called the ontological argument of the existence of God. And there's no argument that I know that can prove the existence of God. That's why it's faith. But this is a rational argument, I think, that you could at least consider. Anselm's point is, if we can think of a being more powerful and awesome than God, more powerful and more awesome than God, then that conception or that being then becomes God. Not the one we had before, because that's greater than the one we thought before. So if that's true, then, in other words, God is the greatest God. That you can't think of anything greater. This is his ontological argument. The greatest guardian that the human mind can conceive. So such a guardian must be all-powerful, must be all-knowing, and must have the superpower of being able to be everywhere at once. God, the super guardian of the universe, who is omnipotent, omniscient, and omnipresent. And you have to admit, the God with those powers is an awesome God. The song that we have sung many, many years in this service, our God is an awesome God. He reigns in heaven above. With wisdom, power, and love, our God is an awesome God. So the first thought I would probably give to it would be the omni. And then the second one would be exactly what Psalm was sung here. The guardian of the galaxy, of all the universe, the guardian of my soul is good. Good, good Father. Psalms. Go to the Psalms. Psalm 34. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Psalm 107, give thanks to the Lord for his good. Even Jesus reminded the rich young ruler who calls Jesus good, and Jesus says, there's only one who is good. If you wish to know life, keep the commandments. Matthew 19. And then you think, well, why is the goodness as an attribute of this guardian so important? Good. Well, there are many who believe that God is evil, an evil tyrant. That God's just waiting for you to have something good happen so that God can take it away and make you miserable. I've talked to people about this concept of God they have. And Anselm would argue that that conception of God is inconceivable. Because a better God can be conceived. If your God is evil, my God does one better because my God is good. Everything about my guardian is good and pleasant. An evil God is by definition or according to reason an inferior God to a super God who is all goodness. So, can God be anything but good? How big is your God? Okay, so I started with omni, then I went to good. The next one, though, I probably would have to go to, if I'm thinking of a guardian of everything, universe, galaxies, and the guardian of my soul, is a guardian who is just. Think about that. God can hardly be unfair, even though you and I might be inclined to think of it and something happens, we go, why me, oh God? I'm going to argue. I understand that. It's a topic. We're not going to talk about theodicy. Why do bad things happen to good people? We understand that. But an unfair God lacks perfection. How can they be God if they're not perfect? Perfect God is one who is just and fair, and if so, then God is just. So God is not only just, but then God is also judge. Well, we don't like to talk about that, right? But it's all through the scriptures. Well, judgment, judge. Someone's judging. Abraham pleaded with God, if you only find 50 people, I can't find 50. Sodom and Gomorrah's over here. It's going to destroy everything. How about 40? How about if you just find 10 people? Okay, I won't destroy it if I find 10 people. And do you see in that story? It's interesting. Didi and I just had a devotional on this in our little booklet on this passage right here. We got into a deep talk on it. Genesis 18. Shall not the judge of all the earth do what is just? Abraham is calling God the judge of the earth. And James does the very same thing in the text I put in the notes there. James 5. Do not grumble against one another, he says, so that you may not be judged. See, the judge is standing at the doors. We like someone who is fair and honest. Particularly, it's a quality that we want in people who are above us or superior to us. Politicians with authority and power, wealthy people who command a lot of people, your parents, your employer, your magistrate, your judge, whatever. And we want them to be fair. We want them to be just. And to be unfair is arbitrary. To be unfair is unkind, unreasonable, and mean-spirited. No one would like a God like that, and probably no one would worship the one who is. So I'm omni, the goodness, and the justice. And I have one more. I mean, you could go on and on. I'm hungry. Okay? Gosh, I had 25 more in here, so and the one is the one you're probably thinking about, the one word that's used every time people say, describe God, or in particular, describe one word of Jesus Christ. What word is that? Love. Right. 98% of people say love. And 1 John 4, God is love. You notice it's a noun. But all through scriptures, it shows that God loves. And you fill in the blank, and that's a verb. God, it's all-powerful and all-knowing, is going to be both. And so it's God's essential nature, pure, all-encompassing, blinding love. And it's seen most perfectly in Jesus Christ. You know the verse. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that hopefully no one will perish, but have eternal life through him. Peter says it kind of in a converse way. He's saying it from the back door in. God is not willing that anyone should perish, but that all should come to repentance. That's that 2 Peter verse. You see, God loves the world. You notice John 3:16 didn't say, for God so loved people. It said, God so loved the world. God loves the natural world, the mountains, the lakes, the meadows, the flowers, that which he called good. God loves sins and saints and sinners alike. God loves millennials, baby boomers. In fact, there's no power in the galaxy. Paul says nothing can separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ. Romans 8. You have to love this garden. This is the one. What is something that you wouldn't like about a God who is omni, who is good, who is just, who is loving? So we can stand with Isaiah in total awe and amazement when God's incredible power and fearful essence are revealed to us in some epiphany for us, some revelation. And when that veil is lifted and we begin to see through these new eyes of faith, we might, like Isaiah, want to cover our eyes as the seraphim covered their eyes, because to see God was to die instantly. And what does Isaiah say? Woe is me, I am lost, for I am a person of unclean lips. Yet my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. But then the most incredible part is yet to come. This awesome God, this omni God, this good God, just God, loving God, looks across the whole of the galaxy, all of the universe, and then in a piercing gaze goes deep into your soul, as he did to Isaiah. And he said, then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? And who will go for us? Then through the power of the Holy Spirit, through your faith in Jesus Christ, you can respond as Isaiah. Here I am. Send me. Let's pray. Lord God, we're so thankful for Isaiah, for the way that he opens our eyes to think big about you, about who you are in our lives as the garden of our lives, and as the garden of this galaxy in which we live. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Son. And thank you, Holy Spirit. Amen.